This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, today, folks, we are going to be exploring a murder mystery that might surprise you on Dreamland, but this is no ordinary murder mystery. This is the result of the research of one of the great authors and researchers of our time, and his wife, Rose, Rand and Rose Flem-Ath. Rand will be with us today. He is the author of When the Sky Fell. He and his wife are the co-authors of When the Sky Fell years ago, the first real book about the possibility of crustal shift as it had been discussed before in some cases. And Rand, welcome back to Dreamland. Subscribers, you can find Rand's previous shows on Dreamland. They've always been very exciting in the archive. So Rand, welcome back.
Well, thank you for having me, Whitley. I appreciate it.
Some of the shows you've done in the past have been absolutely remarkable, and now you're back with, we've talked about Moses before on the show and your research into Moses, but this new book, it just shocked me. How an Egyptian magician assassinated Moses, stole his identity, and hijacked the Exodus. This is remarkable material, and it's very well laid out, but we're going to get into it a few minutes from now. And the reason is I want to go back to the early books about crustal shift. There have now been two of them. Is that correct?
Three of them, actually. When the Sky Fell came out in 95. That was superseded by Atlantis Beneath the Ice in 2012. And in between, I did a book with Colin Wilson called The Atlantis Blueprint. So those are the three. They all cover and are dependent upon the Earth crust displacement theory.
Now, I wonder where we are now with that. And the reason I ask is that the magnetic field of this planet is moving faster and faster every year. But that's the magnetic field, not the crust. And yet there is movement deep within the Earth's core. We know that also. So is this a possibility? Is this something that could happen again?
I believe it will happen again. Hapgood believed it happened over 200 times in the Earth's history. I don't think that it's imminent. Normally, when it happens, the ice caps are at their maximum. The tilt of the Earth is at its maximum. And we won't be under those conditions for another 20,000 years or so. But not to say that there might be another factor I haven't thought of that causes it, like a solar flare or electromagnetic disturbances coming from the sun hitting the Earth at the pole, because the Earth is a magnet. And then though that energy going down into the core, heating up the inner Earth, and then as the heat expands throughout from the center of the Earth to the surface, the asthenosphere, which is that liquid semi-tarry substance between the crust and the mantle, it becomes more liquid. And then, of course, the entire outer crust becomes vulnerable from being tipping over. So the answer is I'm not really expecting another Earth crust displacement. However, we can't rule it out, because the real answer is we don't really know for sure what the causes are of it. We know the effects of it. We can track the effects of it and how it explains many things, like the placement of the ice sheets, the extinction patterns, the origins of agriculture. All those hard sciences are caught in a bottleneck, because they are not willing to consider an Earth crust displacement or possibly a mantle displacement to resolve these issues that have been unresolved for decades now.
Well, sometime around 9000 BC, there was an incredible catastrophe here,
yes,
which we can discuss in a moment. The reason I bring it up in relation to crustal shift is that there exists a geodesic line around the Earth that connects all kinds of sacred sites, from Mohenjo-Daro to Easter Island to Giza to Angkor Wat, all around the planet. Only this line is not oriented horizontally toward the existing physical pole. The pole, if these were all on a line, on a polar axis, would be 1,480 miles west of where it is now. So,
yes, I'm aware of that. That does correspond to Hapgood tracked three displacements, and the oldest one was based, the crust that was over the axis, over the North Pole, if you like, was in the Yukon near Alaska, 65 degrees north, 135 degrees west. And that is around the center of the line that you are talking about that becomes a circle that goes all the way around the world.
Right.
To all these places, yeah. That's not my research that you're talking about, but I am noting that the center for that is where Hapgood placed what we call the Yukon Pole.
The Yukon Pole. Now, what is happening 9,000 years ago, 12,000 years ago, was absolutely extraordinary. The entire North American continent burned and then flooded.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, 9,600 years ago, in Plato's account, there was this incredible flood and deluge. And in America, prior to this, the North Pole was in the Hudson Bay. And so that if you were places like Michigan and New England were within the Arctic Circle, but places like Alaska and Siberia were not inside the Arctic Circle. So you had polar conditions in North America, the remnants of which are the Great Lakes and all the lakes in Canada. These are all remnants of the ice sheet that used to be here, and all of those are within the Arctic Circle when the Earth's crust was situated in the Hudson Bay. We call that Hapgood called that the Hudson Bay Pole. It's a little bit misleading to say that people are thinking that the axis is changing. In a crustal displacement or a mantle displacement, the orientation of the Earth's axis doesn't change. It's just the outer shell of the Earth that changes. So if you're in a Arctic Circle, you might and there's a displacement, as North America was, then you leave the Arctic Circle,
yeah,
and everything melts.
Off you go.
Yeah.
This is not like a gigantic kind of earthquake that destabilizes the surface. The surface looks relatively the same afterwards, doesn't it? It's just in a different orientation.
Yes, that is true. But the other significant change is, of course, with all the melting of the ice, the what is now the continental shelves, which previously were land, goes underwater. So land equivalent to Africa is lost around the edges. But like around Los Angeles, all those islands that are off of land,
right? Sure.
They were a land. You could walk there. The landmass that joined Alaska and Siberia, Beringia. So there was a lot more land before the displacement because so much ice was locked up in North America and Antarctica and Greenland that the ocean level was much, much lower than it is today.
Free Dreamlanders, enjoy these commercials. And why not become a subscriber? You can now. You can subscribe to unknowncountry.com. You can do it through PayPal. You can do it through your credit card. We'll be right back. The new unknown country is finally here, and you can subscribe again. If you don't have a subscription or have never had a subscription, you really ought to think about it. This place is unique in the world. You can subscribe with PayPal. You can subscribe with a credit card, and it's a lot easier. You have to give us only the minimum amount of information necessary in order to run the card. UnknownCountry.com is very security conscious. Your credit card information is never stored on our site. It is stored elsewhere on a site at a much higher level of security than any public site would ever have. So it's extremely safe. Now, why should you subscribe? Well, for one reason, there are a number of shows with Rand Flem-Ath in them in our archive, and there are many, many other shows, Shirley MacLaine, Graham Hancock, all sorts of people, a huge, huge archive dating back to 2004 at this point. I've been doing Dreamland for 20 years, since 1998. I have never missed a show. I've had all of that time to create these wonderful programs, and the program you're listening to now is typical of the quality that we bring. I read these books. I think about them. I have in-depth information myself, which I use in my interviews that you cannot get anywhere else. So yes, there are lots of reasons to subscribe to Unknown Country. Not only that, it's a community. There's a weekly group chat at 7 p.m. Pacific time every Wednesday for subscribers. Of course, there's a free message board as well, because a lot of this website is free. So if you don't want to subscribe but do want to participate, or can't subscribe and want to participate, you can use the free message board. All you have to do is sign up as a user. It doesn't cost a thing. There's also a free newsletter. There's all kinds of free stuff. Plus, of course, the daily news is free, and the first part of Dreamland is free. The first half of the experience is free. The first part of the unseen is free. But there is so much more here. Support this great site and this extraordinary community. It is unique in this world, and probably a few others as well. Doing it is simple. Go to unknowncountry.com right now, click on the subscribe tab, and sign up. See how you like it. Give it a try. Give us a spin for a few months. You'll stay. Practically everybody does. We're talking to Rand Flem-Ath. His new book, The Murder of Moses, by himself, Rand, and his wife, Rose Flem-Ath. Rand, how do you two collaborate, if I may ask?
I do the research. I write up a draft of how the sequence might be, but then Rose turns all that into words that are worthy of reading. Because I don't claim to be a great writer. My skill is in research and putting things together, taking things apart and putting them back together again. The skill of writing, that is Rose's talent.
Let me read something here. I have occupied my whole life with standing up for what I consider to be the scientific truth. Even when it was uncomfortable and disagreeable to my fellow man, I cannot close it with an act of disavowal. Sigmund Freud. Now, why did he say that?
Well, Sigmund Freud spent 40 years researching Moses, and he did it in secret because he came to believe that the real Moses, that there were two Moseses, and the real Moses, in his theory, was an Egyptian, a full-blooded Egyptian. We don't agree with that in our theory, but nevertheless, that was his belief. And he was looking for something, he was looking for the father figure idea, and he saw Moses as the perfect father figure. He needed to have that. And his theory, he was looking to explain why sons want to kill their fathers, in his view. And that was what he thought was happened to Moses. He felt that Moses was basically lynched by his children because they didn't like the power he was having. So, but the problem was that he felt that this was so controversial that he didn't really want it, and especially when you consider that he's living in Austria, and this is the 1930s, and you know, and his daughter Anna has been rounded up by the Gestapo, and he believes that you know that it's time to get out, and he couldn't really say anything about this because what he felt as if to say that the leader of the people of Israel was an Egyptian rather than a full-blooded Hebrew was something that would not be welcomed in the environment in which he lived, the times in which he lived. He died in September 1939, and that's when the book came out in English. His book about Moses, called
about,
Moses.
Yes. Yeah. Now, what is it? Let's trace the life of Moses, the conventional life of Moses as we understand it, from his rescue from the reeds to his leading of the Hebrews out of Egypt.
Sure. Yeah, this is the thing that I found very interesting. I mean, if you contrast him to Joseph, there's a story, a beginning, you know what he's coming into. There's a story that happens. There's a middle. There's an end. Everything is sort of logical. But when it comes to Moses, you have to, when you're reading the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, you have to patch together the story, because at first you think he is alone. Then you find out he has a sister. Then you find out he has a brother. It's all kind of patchworky. So the story, as told in the Torah, which I believe to be a fabrication to a large degree, is that he was born to a descendant of Levi. And during a time when the Hebrew people were slaves in Egypt, and at the time the Pharaoh was trying to kill all the Hebrew people, and so they tried to hide him, but then it wasn't working, so they put him in a basket and set him down the Nile, hoping that he would arrive at the palace, which he does, because the palace is on the Nile, and a daughter of the Pharaoh sees the basket and the baby and takes him out of the ark, and at that point he becomes adopted and is raised as an Egyptian. It's only later, much later, that he learns when he's an adult, and it's a shock comes to us, a great shock to him, that he is not indeed a full-blooded Egyptian, but was born to a Hebrew mother, and therefore that's when he has this incredible, oh my God, what's happening to these people, and he sees a taskmaster. Master, you know, whipping a Hebrew, and he rises up and he kills this guy, and then he buries the body, and then he's got to get out of Dodge because you know, and then he leaves, and he goes and eventually makes his way to Medin, which is an oasis in what we would now call Saudi Arabia, part of Jordan, where his other relatives are already there. And from there, he learns, he studies with Jethro, who is, that's a title. Jethro is the villain in our plot. His name is in Hebrew stories and amongst the Torah and Jewish folklore. He's more notably known as Ruel, which is a word that means God's friend. And he becomes the instructor to Moses. And then the next thing that happens of significance is that he marries the daughter of Ruel. He's a shepherd. But one has to understand that shepherd had more connotations than just caring for animals. It also had religious connotations as well. And one day he's out in the field and he comes across this burning bush, and this voice speaks to him, and you know, this is sacred ground. And then he has this interaction with Yahweh, in which he's given a mission to go to Israel. I mean, go back to Egypt and to free the people there. And he does, and there's a small incident on the way back, incident at the inn, which scholars have been completely baffled by. We won't get into that right now, but he eventually makes it to Egypt, gets into the palace with the pharaoh, performs magical tricks, then brings upon the Egyptians these terrible curses, you know, flies, frogs, floods, earthquakes, and then ultimately the death of the firstborn, except for those who put sheep's blood over their door, so that they're, when the evil forces come, they pass over those doors. They leave those people safe. But all the Egyptian sons who aren't living in a door that is protected by this blood over the door die, and that's when the Egyptians really get mad. But Moses makes his way with the whole. All of his followers to it was actually called the Reed Sea. That's usually identified with the Red Sea, there's this moment when the waves open, and he's able to go through with his followers, and when the Egyptians follow them to try to kill them, the waves crash down on top of them, and on the other side are all the Hebrew people safe, and that's the end of the threat from the Egyptians.
But not then the end of the story. We're going to take a break in just a moment, Rand.
Sure.
The end of the story. What now? It gets really strange because they proceed to wander around in the Sinai Peninsula for 40 years, supposedly.
Yes.
Which is, I mean, I've been to the area, and you could easily walk from Egypt to Israel across the Sinai Peninsula. It would be a hard walk, but you could do it in probably a week, 2 weeks, maybe at most.
But wait.
We're going to take a break. We'll be right back, folks.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
Hi, this is Whitley. You know, The Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy, even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. And the afterlife revolution is going to open the door for you, so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't, when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle. It's available in paperback. And there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something. You can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say, Anne Strieber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today. We're talking to Rand Flem-Ath about his new book, The Murder of Moses. Rand is has done a lot of research into a lot of different areas. He and Rose have written numerous really seminal texts about some very strange stuff. This is certainly one of them. And now, where we were a moment ago was Moses had just begun the mysterious wandering in the Sinai, which took an absolutely inordinate amount of time considering the size of the area. But let's go back, Rand, to Freud again and to a fascinating theory that you bring up in the book that's important to me because I have the same thing from another direction. It is the theory that Moses was taught about the sun god of Akhenaten in Heliopolis and became an advocate for monotheism there.
Yes. Well, this is the heart of Freud said this is the kernel of his theory, that the monotheism is came out of Heliopolis, and he tried to find a way in which he could imagine. He believed that Akhenaten, who had been taught in Heliopolis, that's where he developed the notion of single God. But then, of course, the Egyptians, Akhenaten became very unpopular with the Egyptians. And in fact, he was erased from history, and he's only known through archaeology. He's not known through Egyptian history. He's only known through archaeology. But Freud believed was that the notion of monotheism became a secret society amongst the priests of Heliopolis. And what he says in his theory is all we need is for there to be some evidence that Moses was talking with these priests in Heliopolis. That's what he was looking for, and he never found. What we have put forward in The Murder of Moses is that there were two Moseses, and the first Moses was the third son of Joseph, and there's a lot of support in Egyptian and Roman records to this effect, and that his mother was Asenath, who was a full-blooded Egyptian, but his father was Joseph, who was a Hebrew. So he's not a full-blood, a full-blooded Egyptian, as Freud believed. We don't believe that. His father was Jewish. He was raised, his mother was a priestess in Heliopolis, and his grandfather, who was his only father figure, was the high priest of Heliopolis. And as the high priest of Heliopolis, his grandfather would have been aware and may have even taught the young Moses the theory of monotheism. And so what Freud was looking for and didn't really have the time to complete, because he died before he completed all his research on this, although he did have a very good book on it. He was trying to make a connection between the first Moses and the secret society of monotheists in amongst the priests of Heliopolis. And that's where we believe monotheism was born. That's where Akhenaten acquired his monotheism, and that's where we believe Moses acquired his monotheism.
Now, did Akhenaten acquire it there or originate it there?
Well, he studied there. Let's put it this: he was pharaoh, and he studied there. Heliopolis was always a place where the pharaohs would go to study. It's one of the most ancient cities in Egypt, and one of the most sacred cities in Egypt. And so the priests of Heliopolis have had a disproportionate power over the thinking of the pharaohs. That has come and gone, weighed. Certainly after Akhenaten, they went into decline and other cities became more important. But they were always a force, and they did keep it as the idea of monotheism as a secret. This was a secret that they only passed on to people who they trusted. And since the high priest's grandson was Moses, in our view, he was privy to all of this.
And one wonders why he was there. What would have drawn him?
What would have drawn him to Heliopolis?
Yeah.
Well, his mother was the high priest.
Oh, so of course, understandable.
We have a different take upon his genealogy than what is portrayed in the Torah. We believe that the Torah was written by Levites who had a thing against Joseph, and they wanted to transfer Moses from the house of Joseph to the house of Levi, and that's why they created a false genealogy that put him into the house of Levi. But when you look at Egyptian records, Egyptians' records, Manetho was one of the first Egyptian historians, and in fact, all of the of Egyptology is based upon Manetho, because he divides all the, he tells who everybody was way back there. He was one of the first historians of Egypt, and he tells the story of Moses in there, and he says that Moses was born in Heliopolis. And his name at that time was Osirsef, which is a combination of Osiris, the Egyptian god who was murdered, and Zeph, which is the last half of Joseph. So Osirsef,
well, also
is
Seth,
like,
though, isn't Seth also the murderer of Osiris?
Yes. Well, no. This is Seph, Seph, as like in Joseph.
Oh, I see. So
yeah.
It's not quite the same.
But this whole story of Osiris and Horus and Seth and Isis is very important to this, to what led to the murder of Moses, because it's part of the plot. We call it the blueprint for murder that Ruel used to murder and then replace Moses.
Now, the murderer, I mean, the murdered man was essentially a priest of the solar god.
Well, the first Moses was essentially, he was Joseph's third son, born after Joseph was dead. His mother, his mother was a widow, and she was a high priestess at Heliopolis, and her father was the high priest of Heliopolis. So he's right into where monotheism is being harbored as a secret religion from the day he's born, and he's raised in that tradition as a secret religion.
Because it's so important, because this this is the beginning. We're talking about the roots of our world, basically. Monotheism has become the theism of most of the world outside of the Hindu religion. And so it's terribly, terribly important to understand what was going on there. And when we get back, free Dreamlanders, we're going to be talking more about exactly what this all means. And we're going to be talking a little bit about Akhenaten, too, because, folks, I don't know if you've ever seen any images of Akhenaten. I have. And that guy was weird looking. There's something going on there. We're going to explore that a little bit, too, if Rand wants to. We'll be right back.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From communion to the afterlife revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
We're talking to Rand Flem-Ath, his new book with his wife Rose, The Murder of Moses, How an Egyptian Magician Assassinated Moses, Stole His Identity, and Hijacked the Exodus. Wow, it is an awesome thought there, Rand. And let's go back to Heliopolis where we were. Moses is raised by a mother who is deeply invested in the whole solar disk religion, which looked upon the solar disk as essentially a conscious entity and the only God. Is that correct?
Yeah, certainly. That was the secret religion of the priests of Heliopolis, and this is certainly what Freud believed. And we agree with that was the secret religion of the priests of Heliopolis at the time of Moses.
And he becomes an evangelist, essentially, for what is, at that point in time, a very hidden secret religion, because there has been a revolution in Egypt, essentially, after the death of Akhenaten. Isn't that correct?
Yes, Akhenaten's death coincided with a terrible natural catastrophe, the explosion of Terra, and all those terrible things that went with that, including many of the things that are associated with the plagues that were brought upon Egypt, like the frogs, the earthquakes, the floods, all this sort of stuff that had happened, the blood in the Nile and all that. All those things are explicable in terms of a volcanic explosion on Terra. So there's an association with Akhenaten and terrible death, which the Egyptians interpreted to mean that Akhenaten's monotheism was being overturned by the older gods, and that the best thing to do was to wipe him from history, which they successfully did. As I say, we only know of Akhenaten through archaeology, not through Egyptian writings. They just wiped him clean from the slate because they held him responsible for the catastrophe that overtook them.
Yes, because the explosion of Terra in the Mediterranean at that time caused the collapse of the Cretan state on Crete, and it brought the Old Kingdom of Egypt. It was an enormous event in the area, devastating, a huge volcanic explosion that affected the whole region, and the plagues that came down on Egypt and so on and so forth are all memories of that event, almost certainly.
and completely associated in the minds of the priests of Heliopolis with Akhenaten and with monotheism. So when these ideas are passed on to Moses, when he learns at his grandfather's foot the stories that went what happened, these are parts of the story that are important to him, which he takes with him when he leaves Egypt.
And he leaves Egypt. Why?
Well, I believe the reason he leaves Egypt is because his father is assassinated. Joseph is assassinated, and they by his brother Levi. And as a result of that, because Joseph was held in such high esteem by the Pharaoh, they were expelled. And this is what Manetho, the Egyptian historian, says. He says that they were expelled. This isn't let my people go. This is get out of town. You guys are you killed this important person to us. You better get out or we'll kill you. And so they left Egypt not being freed from slavery, but because the family of Joseph killed Joseph. And then at the time, Asenath, who is Joseph's wife, they already had two sons, was pregnant. And when after all of the Hebrews have left, fearing for their lives, she gives birth to a baby who she names Osirsef, who later becomes known as Moses. This is the account that's given in Manetho. And we only know the account of Manetho through Josephus, who was quite a famous historian of Jewish history.
Right.
And he is basically telling you what's in Manetho, but from a very, very hostile perspective. So we have to patch together what Manetho actually believed. And he believed that the first Moses was Osirsef, a combination of the name Osiris, the person who was murdered by his brother, and we believe that Joseph was murdered by his brother, Levi, and Seth, which is his Joseph. So by naming her child Osirsef, Asenath was declaring to the world, this is my son who was killed by his brother. So, but then later, he came to be known as the son of, and everybody knew what son of, like, because Moses is like MacDonald, Mac anything, you know, it means son of. And so when you say Moses, if you said Moses in those days, people would say, well, this was like saying son of. Well, then they would say son of who? You know, so like it would be Ramesses, would be the son of Ra.
Yeah.
Yeah, etc. So, Moses was not a proper name among the Egyptians. It was just indicating the son of the son of the murdered man, really, basically.
And
that's why they had to leave Egypt. It wasn't being freed. They were leaving because one of their parties killed the important person, Joseph, and that led to their expulsion. This is according to the Egyptians.
Right. Now, this is, when you say it's the expulsion of one family.
Yeah, the whole family, all the Hebrews were associated with them.
So oh, I see. So, because Hebrew means wanderer, doesn't it?
Yeah, but yes, it does, yes.
In other words, they were people who really didn't belong there. They had come from somewhere else.
Well, yeah, you have to remember, too, also that...
Sort of a big extended family.
Pardon? Yeah.
A big extended family. Yeah, I'm understanding now. Okay.
Yeah. So they left because they feared for their lives. And basically, that was it. They were out. But Moses was not yet born at that time. He has two older brothers who did leave, but who part of the children of Israel. But he is left. He is born after. He never knew his father.
Right.
He never met his father. He never saw his father. Yeah.
So he now, what happens then? He's born. He grows up, and at some point, he also leaves Egypt.
Yeah, and the Bible does give us a good indication of that. Pharaoh comes into power who knew not Joseph, and so now this new Pharaoh didn't really like the idea of a person who was not purely Egyptian. You see, because Moses had a Hebrew father in Joseph, so this new Pharaoh says, you know, no, we're not having you in our most sacred places, learning our most sacred secrets. You've got to go. And so he had to flee. So when he fled, he had really no place to go except where the rest of the Hebrews had gone, which is to Midian, which was an oasis in, like I say, Saudi Arabia near the Jordanian border, where Reuel was the high priest and was a follower of the mountain god Yahweh. And that's when we start to get into the whole Yahweh thing and the monotheism that the secret... Now, Reuel himself had been educated in Egypt. It was a policy in those days that if you were of royal blood, that you could go to Egypt, and you could be taught by the priests of Egypt there and learn all their secrets. However, they wouldn't teach you the ultimate secrets if you weren't fully blooded Egyptian. So Reuel was of course fascinated when Moses arrives, because he knows Moses knows the whole secrets. He's got everything that Reuel was denied, including this notion of monotheism. So this is right quite fascinating to him. At the same time, Levi, who had murdered Moses' father, was also there. And he, of course, his first instinct is to kill Moses, rather, Joseph's son, Moses, because he hates everything to do with Joseph, and we can get into that story later if you like. But that's the genesis of the battle between Levi and Joseph is at the heart and turns the whole story of Moses, and also the whole story of the Torah is a battle between the followers of Joseph and the followers of Levi, and the Levites become the scribes. So they move Moses from the house of Joseph, where he was born, into their own house, and they invent a new genealogy, which makes him born into the story that we know. The whole story about the it being in an ark put upon the Nile, that story incidentally comes from Babylonian sources about Sargon, and if you'll see in the book that Sargon did go through this whole thing of being put in a basket and saved, and ultimately became the king. So one of the things that bothered Freud about the story that the Levites wanted the people to believe was that it was a riches to rags story, which was contradictory to everything that he believed would be normal. Joseph is a perfect was an ideal rags to riches story. He's cast in the prison, and his brothers try to kill him. Then they sell him into slavery, and then he's in slavery, and then he gets out of that, and then he comes to be the right-hand man of the pharaoh, and the next thing you know, he's like running the show in Egypt. And so it's a rags-to-riches story. Moses, on the other hand, is a born into these the situation of esteem. He's being raised by the pharaoh's daughter, and then he falls to rags. So it's a riches to rags story, and that really was the thing that bothered Freud. He didn't think that was true. He just couldn't believe that would be the case. He thought that was false, that was made up, and so do we. So that was one of the driving forces in motivating him to write Moses and Monotheism.
And, well, wait a minute, Free Dreamlanders, I almost forgot you. I don't want to forget you ever. I'm so glad that you're here. Now, listen up.
Where do you find Eben Alexander, Dean Radin, Jim Mars, Joseph Farrell, Zechariah Sitchin, William Henry, George Noory, Lawrence Gardner, Trish and Rob McGregor, Marie D. Jones, Marla Fries, Peter Lavenda, Richard Dolan, Starfire Tour, Linda Moulton Howe, and hundreds of others all telling you their deepest secrets? In the Dreamland Archive on unknowncountry.com. Nearly 1,000 exciting, mind-opening interviews, all yours for under $5 a month. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Hours of listening pleasure. Expect to be amazed.
We're talking to Rand Flem-Ath, his new book with his wife Rose, The Murder of Moses, How an Egyptian Magician Assassinated Moses, Stole His Identity, and Hijacked the Exodus. We have not yet gotten to this issue of the assassination of Moses, which is really brain-bending and blood-curdling, frankly, in the book. It's an amazing achievement in terms of research. But before we go there, I want to just briefly touch on Akhenaten and his form. I think that the images of Akhenaten that we have were made during his lifetime, when he was pharaoh, meaning that the artists would have been striving to portray him as he was, in probably in the most flattering possible light. What in the world was wrong with him? Do you know? Have you looked into that at all?
Some people have argued that he had both sexes. He was not
a hermaphrodite.
Hermaphrodite.
Exactly. Well, something like that must have been the case.
Because
but what about
those the
super thin
the
neck and the funny shaped head?
Yeah, but also the hips and also this obsession with singularity. When you have both sexes, there's an obsession with singularity. So the idea of monotheism would ring true to you, especially if you were the pharaoh.
So, in other words, his ambiguous sexual identity was what may have drawn him to monotheism.
Well, I believe that is certainly. We don't put forward that idea in the book.
No, you don't. But it's a fascinating idea anyway.
That is a plausible explanation for his appearance, is what I'm saying, and also for his extreme devotion to the idea of a single god, because he himself, to forget, is virtually a god.
Yeah,
and
because
if he has both sexes, then the notion of singularity resonates with him.
He was effectively a fanatic, because, folks, if you look back at that time, Egypt was, like the rest of the known world, a place filled with different gods who all had different purposes and different meanings and different importances in your daily life. And now suddenly here was the pharaoh saying, they don't even exist. Only God exists is the solar disk itself, which is a conscious being with whom you can have a relationship. Now, oddly enough, I came across a scientific paper, I guess it's really a quasi-scientific paper, a few months ago, arguing that some stars may be conscious. And this argument is based on the fact that certain stars orbit around the galactic center at impossible speeds, that is to say, at the wrong speed. They should all be orbiting at the same speed, but instead, some of them seem to be different in many ways. Now, I'm not going to go down that path right now, but let's just assume that this man was an absolute fanatic, and he built something that then went underground, like the pagan movement did in the Middle Ages, and became a super secret but quite elite group of people. Is that correct?
Yes, that's certainly the thesis of a number of Egyptologists. Jan Osman it put forward the idea of a counter-religion, the idea of something that is opposite to everything that is known. And certainly, Akhenaten's ideas were the opposite of everything that was known at that time. At that time, multiple gods, multiple ways of serving different gods, and then he says, no, let's start destroying all these statues of gods and let's just replace them with a single god. There is only one god, and that is the sun, as represented by, as symbolized, or as actually is the sun. That was the belief of Akhenaten. But he had the misfortune of having this volcano thing go off. And then the Egyptians thought, oh, that's because he's turned against the gods, and the gods have brought revenge upon him for having this blasphemy against their gods.
Yeah. And, of course, they thought he probably thought that it was their resistance to his god that caused it. They would have thought, and his priests at Heliopolis, the others would have thought it's his fault for denying the gods.
Yeah, that was the popular people in the street who are experiencing these terrible events. They blame the pharaoh for deviating from the religious beliefs of the forefathers. That's the common reaction to that. What was the common reaction to Akhenaten? He was hated for having, disgraced his position as pharaoh.
And wrecked the country.
Wrecked the country, yeah.
Right, exactly. So we can well understand that. But here's the interesting thing. Monotheism leaves Egypt in the person of this man Moses. Then something happens. Something very strange happens. All of a sudden, his whole personality changes. Tell us about the Moses before the change and the Moses after the change.
Okay, so the Moses before the change, Joseph's son, a follower in the sense of Akhenaten, was a vegetarian. He wouldn't be doing sacrifices. He wouldn't be doing animal sacrifices. He was a pacifist. He was a very, there was no wars of aggression during Akhenaten's time. He was a pacifist. He was, kind of a hippie-like character, if you like. And he's very mild. He doesn't bring attention to himself. He's humble, and he just spends his time in the wilderness communicating with God and being with the animals he's taking care of. Also, when he comes home at night, he is instructed by Reuel, who is the priest of Yahweh, and as the information exchanges between Moses and Reuel, Reuel starts to think, oh, this is a good idea. We should do that. And so, you know, first of all, though, he wants to have it's important to understand who Reuel is. He had, in his mind, the most noble bloodline of all, because his mother, Basemath, was the daughter of Ishmael, the founder of the Arabs. And his father, Esau, was the firstborn of twins of the father of Isaac, the father of the Jews. So Reuel is the first person on planet Earth who can trace his bloodline to Abraham, both through his mother and his father. So he considers himself to be the proper heir to the leadership of the Hebrew people. And bear in mind, his father, Esau, had a twin brother, Jacob, who later came to be known as Israel, who Israel, or Jacob in this case, deceived Isaac at the time of the blessing and impersonated Esau to acquire the leadership of the Hebrews. So through an act of impersonation by Jacob, he was imitating, he was impersonating his brother, Esau. Isaac granted him the leadership of the Hebrew people. So, and that disenfranchised Reuel, because Reuel's father is disinherited. So now, Reuel has a motive to kill and replace Moses, because he thinks himself of himself as the most noble bloodline, and that. But before he kills him, he marries him off to his daughter Zipporah, and waits until they have two children, and then he can kill Moses. But before he can kill Moses, he has an operation that he wants to send Moses back to Egypt for, and that is to obtain the skull and bones of Joseph. Because for Reuel, and as all magicians at that time, the possession of your enemy's skull and bones was a means by which you could control demonic forces. So he had a very high motive of wanting to get Joseph's bones.
This, incidentally, folks, is one of the great secrets of the secret society known as Skull and Bones. Go ahead.
Yes. So when Moses is sees at the burning bush, Yahweh, who we believe to be Reuel, says, "Take off your shoes, where you stand is sacred," which is probably what he said every night. And that was a hypnotic suggestion that you should go into a trance. And so he did go into trance. And in the trance, he sees this burning bush, and he's told, okay, you have to go off and supposedly free your people. But the real mission, is something that only Moses, the first Moses, can do. That is, retrieve the bones of his father. Because Reuel doesn't know where they're buried, nor could he go back to Egypt and just go digging around for bones. But Joseph had every right, Joseph's son had every right to return to Egypt and retrieve his bones. And that's exactly what Moses does. Apart from doing all these magical tricks with the Pharaoh and all that stuff, when he comes back, he carries with him Joseph's bones. And so those bones are then... Moses is back, and once the bloodline of Joseph is added to all the bloodlines of the people who Reuel thinks are the most important, Abraham, Isaac, Joseph, Ishmael, all the children of Israel, except for Joseph, and now Joseph's son is married to his daughter, and their children are now the genetic pool that is the most sacred in his view. And those people ultimately continue to exist and exist today. And that's another story. But the real mission of going to Egypt was not to free the Hebrews. They were already in Midian. The real mission was to retrieve Joseph's skull and bones for Reuel's acts of magic.
And then Moses is murdered. And the world changes so profoundly. And in the final half hour of the show, subscribers, we are going to get into this extraordinary journey from that single God called Yahweh to Christianity and the modern world. It's going to be quite a ride. Free Dreamlanders, thank you so much, as always, for listening up on Dreamland. And why not do what we've been asking you to do all along through the show, which is become a subscriber. Then you don't have to listen to us whining anymore, and you get access to our huge archive on unknowncountry.com, our brand new unknowncountry.com, including the other shows that Rand has been with us on, which have been absolutely fascinating. And this is a great interview. I mean, he says to me, I'm working on humility. And that's just fine, Rand, but you're still really, really good at what you do. Thank you so much for being with us, Free Dreamlanders subscribers. We're going to keep on for another half hour and get into the real nitty-gritty here.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.